Welcome today of the super exciting proceedings of the Teachathon event. In today's scenario, when artificial intelligence is proceeding, paving way paths to business reach new heights, it is my immense pleasure to introduce our supporters, AI School. The Meritus AI Learning Experience Private Limited is a Chennai-based startup which was incorporated in 2020. The company has two online portals to teach artificial intelligence and coding. So let me call upon Mr. Borve Carcintio to help us understand the more about this organization, followed by insights on artificial intelligence technologies in the classroom. Mr. Borve has an engineering background with a focus on scientific research and development at SRM University, Chennai. He took to the idea of STEAM education. He has more than 7 years of experience in the development of curriculum, lesson plans, and activities in STEAM for kindergarten to 12th grade students. His approach is by walking a mile in their shoes and use the creativity and references so that students can relate to what they are learning. He began his role as a curriculum developer at Robotics and then took the role as a STEAM educator. Before assuming his current role as an academics head, whereupon he ensures that the same devotion and passion that is shown towards educational content creation for the children is also being followed by his team. It's a pleasure having you here, sir. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Priya ma'am. I hope that I am audible to everyone.
Yes.
Okay, good. Good morning to everyone gathered over here. And I'm sure you're all very excited to learn more about how we're going to implement AI in the classroom. I'm sure as fellow teachers, you would have already done your research and checked out a lot of different avenues and a lot of different resources available online. So let me just demonstrate to you how we at AI School of India do that, how we have done our research, how we have also been teaching AI education since last year, June 2020, via various workshops, even through teacher training presentations, and even to students and through some online webinars as well. All right, so let me share my screen and we'll get into it. And as many of our esteemed speakers during the Teachathon, yesterday's Teachathon said, I don't want to make it just a session where I'm just talking. We will also have an interactive session with all of you teachers as well. So let me get started and share my screen. All right, so once again, good morning, everyone. Let us just begin. Artificial intelligence technologies in the classroom. Let us begin as teachers. Let's begin with a question. What comes to your mind when you hear the word artificial intelligence? Can I see some answers in the chat box, please? We'll just pause for a minute, and you can please provide your answers in the chat box. What comes to your mind when you hear the word artificial intelligence? Okay, I see Mr. Anam saying programmed condition. Very good. Robots, yes, that's something that we get from the children also, you know, they always say robots. Human imitation, yes, that's true. Yes, any other answers? Something that's not natural, yes. Artificial, when we translate it, it means not natural, something man-made. All right. Okay, as you're keeping on giving your answers, we will just go to the next one. So, why we are teaching artificial intelligence? It's because as teachers, I'm sure we all observe that our children are growing up around AI-powered devices. They are, I'm sure most of us have an Amazon Alexa or some kind of virtual assistant in our homes, just a simple smart speaker. Or if not, we are already using the virtual smart assistants on our mobile phones. We've been using Amazon to order stuff online. We'll be watching Netflix or we'll be listening to songs on Spotify, and it's automatically recommending these songs or the videos or movies to us. So our lives are totally and slowly getting integrated with AI technology. So how are we as teachers going to help the students, you know, better prepare themselves for a future where AI is going to become something as natural as, say, we're reading a newspaper or today or watching a movie? Let's see how we can go about that. So according to the Britannica Encyclopedia, this is the definition of AI. It is the ability of a computer or a robot controlled by another computer to do the tasks that are usually done by humans, because these tasks require human intelligence and discernment. But how do we make this definition much simpler for a child? So we can tell them, we can tell it in this way. It is the ability of a computer or a robot or a software or even an intelligent machine to think, act, and behave just like a human being. So just to show them in a different way also, how do humans think, how they teach, and how they behave, if the AI can do the same thing, then it is said to be artificially intelligent. So this is also something that is being implemented by the, thanks to the NEP 2020, which is the topic of this year's Teachathon. So how are we going to do that? How are we as teachers going to provide this AI for all? We are the front runners in any kind of race. We are the ones who will be leading the children. So how do we go about this? How do we empower them to become digitally literate? So also, how do we help them prepare for the future? How do we help them become future ready? As we can see from these statistics itself, the number of AI job postings is slowly getting, it's going higher and higher, right? And some of the highest paying salaries these days are also in jobs that are related with AI. Say, for example, if you look over here, director of data science, deep learning engineer, senior data scientist. And as I'm sure that you would have seen in the news recently, one girl from Pune who got hired by Adobe with a salary premium salary package of 41 lakhs per annum. So how do we help the children? These are the most sought after jobs these days. How do we help the children prepare for that? And as we can see over here, AI is also going to get, it's going to be used in all different avenues, whether it's healthcare, entertainment, banking and finance, manufacturing. It's getting integrated in all these different avenues. So a little bit about our platform. As Priya ma'am already introduced, we are an online self-directed and tutor learning platform. And we are a team of educators and technologists from all over the world, not only here in India. We've got expert advisors from various countries for helping us in preparing the curriculum for the children. So the definition of AI was first coined by Dr. John McCarthy in the year 1955. He defined it as the science of and engineering of making intelligent machines. And this is how we are teaching AI to the children. I'm sure as teachers, I'm not sure whether you've heard of this. This is something called as the 5 big ideas of AI as proposed by the AI for K-12 initiative from the United States. So this AI for K-12 initiative is a group of computer scientists and teachers who have put together these curriculum guidelines. All right. So they work together and they propose these 5 steps. What these 5 steps talk about is they will help the students identify what is an artificial intelligence and what is not. All right. So take for example, if you're taking a particular software or you're taking a robot or a program or even a computer, how do we say that it is having artificial intelligence? It has to undergo these 5 steps. Let's go through them one by one. All right. And let's also take the example of a virtual smart assistant. I'll just read them out for you. So the first five big ideas are perception, comprehension, learning, natural interaction, and impacts of AI. We will also do a little activity after this, okay, to help you get the idea of these 5 big ideas of AI as well. All right. So I'm sure many, as we spoke about earlier, I'm sure many of you have an AI device like this at home, where it's helping you or it's also constantly learning and listen. I mean, it's learning from you by listening to you. Even though you switch it off, I'm sure some of you would have seen that, the news that these devices are always constantly listening to you. Even your mobile phone, if you're keeping it, in your pocket or in your bag, it is constantly taking in data, whether it's your location data or your voice data, it's all constantly listening to you. So let's look at these 5 big ideas one by one. So perception is how computers perceive the world around them using sensors. Just as how we humans perceive the world around us using our 5 senses, computers use sensors. Right now you're able to see me, thanks to the webcam on my laptop. All right. And if you take the example of the Amazon Alexa device, it's constantly listening to us using its microphone sensor. It's collecting the data. Right now, my webcam is sending my video data and image data over to you. The same thing with the microphone on my webcam as well. It's sending the audio data over to you. But is it collecting it? That we don't know. All right. So right now, my computer is just perceiving me and sending the data over to you. Now, the next step is comprehension. Now, comprehension is another way of saying, how does a computer understand the data it is collecting? Or how does it maintain representations of the world around it? Now, this data that is coming over to you, this image data, this video data, this audio data, how does a computer understand what kind of data it is? So it has to collect it into the form of representations or data sets and store them in those particular data sets. The next one is learning. So over here, what this is called is, we can break it down into three simple steps. How does a computer collect and understand the data? How does it learn from the patterns in data? And how does it apply what it has learned? Excuse me, can you please ask that you don't draw on the screen? Thank you. The next of the five big ideas is natural interaction. Now, this one is, how do we help the computer or the robot or the intelligent machine? How do we help it become as human as possible? How does, now take for example, your Amazon Alexa device or your Google Home device. How does it speak to you? It speaks to you in a human voice, right? You can program it to speak to you in a woman's voice or in a man's voice. So how do we make that interaction as human as possible? And last but not least, the impacts of AI. How does the AI that we are programming, how does it help the human race? Is it in a positive way or is it in a negative way? We have to look at that. One positive example of an AI is, you know, these days, they are learning from us and they can understand and help us and give recommendations, especially for people who are elderly. Like they can detect when someone has fallen down or when someone, when they need to take their medicine and prescribe, give prescriptions to them. A negative impact of AI is some of the big companies, big tech companies, what they're doing is they're using AI algorithms to screen through their applicants. And sometimes these algorithms can be programmed to demarcate people based on their gender, based on their race, based on their community that they come from. So this is one negative impact of AI. So as I mentioned earlier, let us have a look at the five big ideas of AI with the help of a program. All right. So just let me share my screen and what I'm going to do is I'm just going to share a link with you teachers. So I'm providing a link in the chat box. And this link will give you access to a programming platform that we use. All right. This is called Scratch for AI. And I'm sure many of you teachers are familiar with the Scratch programming platform. But this is a platform that we have just built on top of it. We're using the open source nature of Scratch. So what we've done is we've created our own AI extensions, okay, which give us access to AI functionalities to make sure that whatever programs we create on the Scratch platform have access to AI functionalities or AI services. All right, so please click on this link and open it up, and we shall go into a program to further understand how we can convert this this webcam, simple webcam that you're seeing me right now, or you are using one, to make it into an artificially intelligent webcam. All right. And I also request you teachers to please, if you have some objects on your table, like for example, I'm going to be using a couple of objects to demonstrate this with me. So I have a mug. I think my virtual screen is not allowing me. And I'm going to be using a book as well. All right. So please, if you have any objects on your table, I request you to keep something that has two different shapes, maybe something like a rectangular shape and something like a circular shape. If you have that with you on your table, please keep it ready with you. All right. And I'll just, in the meantime, while you're keeping those objects ready, what I'll do is I'll just share my other screen just to give you an idea of what we'll be doing. Okay. Now, is this screen visible to you, teachers? Priya, ma'am, is this screen
visible? Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. So, how do we teach the idea of machine learning to the children? I'm sure many of us know that machine learning is a very complex topic. It's not something that we can teach easily. It is something that is being taught in colleges, and it is something that can be being taught in universities as well. How do we teach this idea of machine learning to kids? So for this, what we can do is one very simple way of teaching machine learning is how we break it up into simple definitions. One is to put it in simple words, it is a process carried out where a computer or intelligent machine or a robot, how does it do these three steps? Okay, how does it collect the data into data sets? How does it learn from the collected data? And how does it apply what it has learned? So for this, what we're going to do, we're going to be using the Scratch for AI platform. Oh, and by the way, teachers, this is also an example of a lesson plan that we are using, okay, for AI. So we follow these particular steps. I'm sorry, I didn't mention it earlier. So let me go back a bit. All right. So we follow something called as the Ask, Imagine, Plan, Create, Remix, and Share platform. Okay. This is just our take on the inventive learning, the inventive thinking principle. All right. So first we start with Ask. What is machine learning? This is the topic that we're going to go about. And the next one is imagine. So how we tell the kids, how are we going to be doing this? How are we going to be carrying out machine learning in the classroom? So first, how do we collect the data? We're going to be using the webcam to capture different image data samples of different hand gestures or even of different objects or whatever is there in the front of the screen, all right? Next is, how do we train the program to identify the different hand gestures or the objects as well? We'll be using the machine learning extension in the Scratch for AI platform. And then next is the application. How do we make the program speak a certain keyword when, say, a hand gesture is shown or even when the object is shown? All right. So what do we need? We'll be needing three different labels or three different data sets. And so now we will go into the creation. All right. Now I'll just share my screen and let's do it step by step. All right. So wait, just give me a second. I'll just switch to my screen. Yeah. And I hope, teachers, you can all see my screen over here. Is the program screen visible to you? Thank you, ma'am. Okay. Now, let us go through it one by one. So what was the first step? Collection of data, right? So let us begin with that. And for that, what we need to do is, if you can see on my screen, we will go down here to the bottom left. There is a green color box. Okay. That is an add extensions box. So let's click on that first. And as you can see, we have some AI extensions over here, which give you access to AI functionalities like speech recognition, sentimental analysis, face detection, and machine learning. For this particular session, we'll be using the machine learning blocks. So please click on that. And once you do, all right, you can see that these machine learning blocks become enabled in the tools palette. Great. And your screen also becomes visible. I can see me on the Scratch stage over here. All right, you can also see yourself on the Scratch stage. So have you all done this? Okay, so let us go to the first step, okay, of machine learning, that is collection of data. Now, as I mentioned earlier, I've requested you to keep some objects ready with, in hand. So first, for the collection of data, let us take this train label one and place over here. And we will also take another one, train label two. So we're going to train the computer to recognize two different objects. Okay. So we're going to be using this. You can add more. I mean, you can try this at home later. You can try with different labels as well. All right. So for this purpose of this session, we're going to be training the computer to recognize two different objects. Okay. Now, to begin the collection of the next step in the collection of data, we will just enable these counts of label one and counts of label two over here in the scripts palette. So just check the box over here, counts of label one and counts of label two. So this will show you how much data you have collected, okay? So now to begin the collection of data, we will have to double click on this train label one and train label two. Okay, but don't start now. First you get the object ready. So let me move this a bit. Yeah, all right. So let's keep the object ready. I have a mug in my hand. I'm going to use this as my first object. So I'm just going to keep this in front of the camera. Okay, and then click on train label one. I request you teachers to also do the same with the object that you have. Okay, so once you click on train label one, you'll get a dialog box that says that the training process has begun. Just click on okay. And then you will see in the counts of label one, okay, that one has come. So to continue adding the image data sample, you just have to click on train label one again and again. So what we shall do is we shall continue clicking until we reach a number of 50. Okay, we are going to provide the computer with about 50 image data samples of this mug. Okay, it can be 51 also, not a problem. So I hope that you've collected around 50 image data samples of the object, whatever object you're using. Is everyone done? Okay, so yeah, so we shall go to the next object. So similarly, what we need to do is just take, as I mentioned earlier, you take another differently shaped object. So we're taking a rectangular object over right now. So I'm just going to keep this in front of the webcam and now click on train label two. Okay, so as I click, it's taking image data samples or snapshots of this object. Okay. And I'm again providing with about 50 image data samples. Okay. So we have completed the first step of machine learning, which is the collection of data. Now we have the image of the mug, all right, in trainable one, and we have the image of the book in trainable two. All right. Now, what is the next step? How do we help the computer learn from that data? So for this, what we're going to do, all right, so we're going to create a conditional. So for that, what I request you teachers to do, please go to the these command blocks over here and then click on control. All right. And please take out this if then block over here. Take that out first and take out another one because we have two different data sets. So we're going to use two different conditionals. Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Can I ask you something? I may missed out.
Oh, okay. Yeah, please, ma'am. What do you like to know?
Meena, ma'am?
Yes, Meena, ma'am.
Ma'am, you're on mute.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
I missed out a few things. It's like I made that, but I didn't get that counting part. The object counting, I am not getting. How can
okay,
I do
not
that?
A problem. I'll just demonstrate it again. So okay, I'll just go back to the image. So over here in the command block categories, I just click on the machine learning with blocks, machine learning with the scratch blocks. Okay, so I'll just demonstrate it again. I have taken out earlier the strainable one and stored the mug. Okay. Mug image data samples inside this one. And for train label two, I have kept the book image data samples. So now I'm going to use a completely different object. So I'll just take out train label three. All right. And let me just use a circular object like this. So let me just keep it in front of the screen. Okay. So keep it as close to the camera as possible so that because what this program does is it recognizes the object based on its shape and its color. Okay. So what we're going to do is I'm just going to, before that, I go down to this counts of label three over here on the left-hand side. I just enable it so that I can see how many counts of the image data samples are there in label three. Now keep the object in front of the camera and then just start clicking on train label three. So you can see one image data sample has been added to the train label three. I'll keep clicking it again. Okay. And I keep clicking until I get about 50 image data samples. Okay. So now we have three different objects being stored in these three different data sets. Okay. So in train label one, we have of the mug. Train Label 2, we have of the book, and Train Label 3, we have of the cup, paper cup.
Okay, thank you, sir.
No problem, ma'am. So you can also do, we'll have a discussion after this, but yeah. So now we have completed the first step where we collected the data. Step number 2 is, how do we help the computer learn from that data? What should the computer do when it sees a particular object? So for that, we're going to use these conditional blocks over here, the if-then blocks. So after taking out these if-then blocks from the control block categories, what we're going to do next is we go to the operator blocks, these green color blocks over here, and we take out the equals to block, okay? Now, after having taken out these two blocks, we will go back to the machine learning blocks, all right? And we will take out this label reporter block over here and put it inside the left-hand space inside the equals to block, okay? So put it one for each of the other, okay? So now to start with the first phase of the conditional statement, we are just going to change this value over here from 50. Just click on this, it'll get highlighted, and just enter one on your laptop or your computer, whatever you're using. So what happens is we're going to point this to the first data set, okay? And if we drag this and put it inside in this conditional block, it becomes the first part of the condition. If label is equal to one, that is, if it goes to the first label, what should it do, okay? Now, similarly, for the second condition, we'll just change this to value to two, and put it over here. All right, so two conditions, one each pointing to the different two different data sets, one for the mug and one for the book or whichever objects you've used. Now we have half of the condition. All right, what is a condition without an action, without a corresponding action? So one very simple action we can give is we will make the robot over here, the sprite over here, say the name of the object, okay? So for that, what we're going to do, we just go to the looks blocks over here, click on it, and then we will take out this say block. Okay, it's written as say hello, but we can change the value. So please take this out and put it inside this if block over here. Similarly, do the same for the second conditional block. Now, we're going to make the robot speak the name of this particular object that is there in train label one. So as we remember, in train label one, it is mug. And in train label 2, it is book. Okay. So the two conditions are complete. All right. And we have completed step number 2. That is how we are going to make the computer learn what is, you know, learn from the data that is collected. Okay. So let us further complete this program. Let us put these two together. Okay, in a sequence. So if the label is equal to one, it should say mug. And if the label is equal to two, it should say book. To put it in simpler terms, if the computer sees the object, it should say the name of the object, all right? Now, let us complete the program by putting it into a loop. So for that, we are going to just click on control and then take out the forever block, okay? And place these blocks inside this forever block, okay? And we also need to give a bit of processing time also as well. So we will take out two wait blocks. Okay. And just give and then change the value of this 1 second to 0.5. So we will give a bit of time for the computer to also, to just wait and see before it recognizes the object as we change it in between. All right. So the program is almost ready. We just add a start block to start it off. So we click on events and then click on this when green flag is clicked. All right. Now, our program is complete. We only have to test it out. So what we're going to do is put the object in front of the camera and then click on the this green button, this green flag over here to start the program. All right, so mug, let me take the second object. So as you can see, based on the shape of the object and you know the color, it's recognizing it. Is everyone getting similar results? I hope the other teachers are also getting similar results. Okay, so now, as we mentioned earlier, let us break this program down and, you know, and compare it with the five big ideas of AI. Now, what was the first one? It was perception, right? So how is the computer perceiving the objects? It is through the webcam, right? So first step number one is done, perception. It's perceiving whatever objects, whether the mug or the book or even the paper cup that we used earlier, it is perceiving it using the camera sensor, okay? It's doing something called as computer vision. Now, step number two was comprehension. How did we help the computer understand what kind of data it's collecting? We use these blocks, the train label blocks, okay? And we also help the computer store the data in the form of data sets, all right? So train label one was for the mug data set and train label two was for the book data set. Now, step number three, learning. Sorry, ma'am. I'm sorry, ma'am.
Participants, can you mute yourself, please? Thank you.
All right. So, yes, coming back to step number three, which is learning. How do we help the computer learn from the data that is collected? Okay. So we have just applied a condition over here where if the computer sees the first object, it will say the name of the object, okay? And if it sees the second object, it will say the name of the second object. Now, the fourth one, which is natural interaction. Over here, what we have done is we've simply just provided a display a display of the name of the object. How do we make it more interactive? How do we give it a human voice? That we can also do by providing a text-to-speech block, okay? So I request you teachers to please come back with me to the extensions block over here, this green color box at the bottom left, add extension. Please click on this and then please click on this text to speech block over here. Okay, now we have something called as a speak block. So please take that out and place it below the say block over here and take out another one and place it below the say block over here. Now, similarly, what we can do is we'll just need to change the name. So it's going to say, it's going to display the name of the object and it's also going to speak it out, okay? So same thing over here. So now step four is also done, natural interaction. Let's test it out again. I'm just going to place the object in front of the camera. I'm not sure if you're able to hear it, but yeah, it is saying mug. I guess you're also hearing it on your own systems as well, okay? So we've completed step four as well, natural interaction. Now, coming to step five, impacts of AI. Where do you think this particular type of program can be utilized? Can I see some answers from the teachers? Where do you think this kind of program can be used? You can just take a guess also. Teachers, any idea where such a program can be used? Airport, colleges, very nice. Okay, nice answers. Yes, for recognizing objects, right? Anything else? Hospitals, logins? Yeah. Okay, I will give you an example. Sometime back we had conducted a competition for students from all over India. So most of them use this program to identify whether someone was wearing a mask or not, especially in these, we're still, recovering from this pandemic situation. So what students did is they made sure that they trained the computer to recognize their faces when they were wearing a mask and when they were not wearing a mask, all right? Now, one application of this, I'll just share my screen again to the presentation, just please give me a second. Yeah. So one example of this that I can, I'm going to give you is, now I'm sure many of you have heard of Microsoft. We're all using Microsoft products at home or in our schools and universities. So Microsoft has developed something called as the Seeing AI app, and it's very useful for people who are blind. So what this app does is it uses computer vision, similar to what we did today, to read text, scan barcodes, recognize images, etc. And then it will narrate the world around them for people who are blind or visually challenged. So we have created a program which is very similar to that for blind people, okay? Now, this is a very simple program that can be created in a matter of 10 to 15 minutes. And, you know, that students can also try out at home and they can experiment and try with different objects and see how the computer recognizes and learns from those particular shapes. Let me show you another example of a program. This is a little big, it's a bigger program. All right, just give me a second. I'll just pull it up for you. I hope my screen is visible. And I think you can see some dots around my face as well. All right. So this is a program called as PostNet. So let me just, it's a huge program. As you can see over here, we have programmed each and every one of these dots to correspond to different parts of the human anatomy. All right, so let me just run this program and demonstrate it. So as you can see, it is, these dots are corresponding to different parts of my anatomy, as I said. They are corresponding to the way I move my arms, okay? And you can't see, but yeah, they're also looking at, the, you know, we're programmed them to look at the legs as well. And as you can see, they also follow the points on my face, like they correspond to my eyes, my ears, my nose, okay? So let me just stop the program. Now, this program is quite, it's a very huge and complex program. So what we have to program it to correspond to each and every one of the different body parts, okay? And they correspond to the X and Y coordinates of these different body parts. Like say, for example, over here, left eye, X and left Y. And these are the blocks that we're using, okay? So as you can see over here, these are called as the PostNet blocks, and they correspond to each and every one of the different body parts like hip, knee, and all, and so on. All right. So it takes time. It'll take about a full class for the students to program each and every one of these different dots. Okay. And they can also give different colors if they want. They can give the different colors for the eye dots and for the arms and legs and so on. Okay. So this is an example of how we can teach such a concept. I'm not sure. If your teachers have explored something called as just give me a second. I'll just share my screen to the other one. So there is something called as teachable machines that is promoted by Google. So in teachable machines, what students can do is they can just try out different AI experiments. So some of these experiments are like the image project, the program which I showed you earlier, how you can train the computer to recognize different objects. So you can also do the same thing with the audio project as well and post project. But what happens over here is there is no programming happen. You're just training it, all right? Say for example, if we go to the post project, you're just switching on the webcam, doing some movements, okay? And the students, and you just train the computer to recognize a particular movement, okay? Whether you're going to hold your hands up or you hold the hand down, train it and apply it to different classes or different training labels as we did earlier. But if we have a look at the program that I showed you earlier, you're programming each and every one of these dots. So the same thing can be done also, but in a way, the children are learning by creating their own program instead of just playing around with it. So this is the advantage that using a platform like this can give for the teachers as well as for the students. You know, they learn by creating their own programs. All right. So that is my demonstration. If teachers have any questions, please feel free to ask them right now. We'll enter to a time of Q&A. Yeah, how can we change the color of the blocks? Which blocks do you mean, ma'am? Because those blocks have been color coordinated. If you're talking about the, if you're talking about the blocks which are there in the program, they've been color coordinated, okay? Assembling. I'm not sure I understand what you mean. Because if you're talking about the blocks which are there in the program, they have been color coordinated already to correspond to different programming features like for conditionals or for for looks, they're purple in color. For operations, they're green in color. It's like that. I'm not sure what blocks you're talking about, ma'am. Elaborate. Yes, ma'am.
Sir Ghazala here. I'm talking about the blocks you have taken, green blocks, purple blocks, like that I'm saying.
That's what, ma'am. Yeah, those are already color coordinated by the platform. We can't change them.
They are designed like that only.
Yes. We can't change those blocks.
Okay. That I'm asking. Thank you, sir.
No problem, ma'am. Any other questions, please? What we can do is we can also share some resources with you as well. Something that you can try at home. I can share with Ms. Priya, and she can share with the teachers as well. We have some PDFs and some some sample lesson plans that you can try out at home with the platform. I've already provided the link, so you can always use that link anytime. You can explore more. You can try with the program that I showed you also. You can try out different features at home as well with your children or even with your students. They can try out different objects and train them. And you can modify the program as much as you want. It's up to you as teachers. Yeah. How do we implement AI in language in the classroom? Ms. Mona Lisa, how do you mean about that, ma'am? Can you please just elaborate?
Actually, I wanted to say if we are taking some literature or some kind of poetry, because I'm teaching English, so yes, we do that in AI-based?
Good question, ma'am. Yes, yes. What I will do is, just let me show you an example. Okay, so now what we're doing over here in this particular program is we're using something called as the language recognition block. Okay, so over here, this block over here. So what we're going to do is this particular block, what it does something called as web access. So this web access, it'll go to a search engine like say Google or Yahoo Bing, and it will carry out the results. So if I run now, let me just break down this program for you. So when the program starts, it's going to speak and say, type a sentence and I will identify the language. And it'll also ask a dialogue box will appear over here. And now this particular block over here, it's going to recognize the language. It's been programmed to recognize different languages, okay? So let's say, for example, I type something like this. Let me just run it again. Okay, so it's saying the language is French. If you teachers can provide me some other sentence, some other phrases as well, and we can just type it out. You can please type in the chat box. We can test it out in this particular program. Very good, ma'am. Okay, so depends on how. Let me try this one also. So we can use how did that get there? I'll just type it out. All right. So it's what it does is it carries out the web access and web retrieval to get the result as to which particular language it is. So you can use something like this to get the students excited. Let me also just show you another program, ma'am. Just let me share my other screen. So this is another one, which is it's a language translation program. It's quite huge. So what we're going to do is it's going to ask for the input either in text or either in speech. So let us use it in text and let me try this out. And what we're going to do is we can set it to different languages also. Right now it's set to French, okay? We can also set it to different languages like Arabic, Croatian, Chinese, and all. Okay, Polish. So right now I'm just setting it to French and it's going to provide me the answer also in French. So let's run this program. So enter your choice below, text or speech. I'm just going to use text. Okay. Enter your text, the AI will translate. Let's use something simple. How are you? So it didn't recognize the last symbol. So I'll just do it again. I'm entering the choice text. And how are you? Okay. I think just give me a second. Text. Hello. Bonjour. Okay, so it's not taking the long sentences, I mean, long phrases that much. We can try. If you can also provide me, let's try something different. Let's change it to maybe thigh. Okay, I just need to change the parameters over here also. Let's run it again. Text, and then hello. It takes a bit of time also. I think it's not able to get it. Okay. So it takes a bit of time for it to get the information. There is also, we also have another platform called as FiroPort, which where the children can create their own apps on a mobile phone as well. And maybe we can do it for another session. We can have that. So there are a lot of different platforms that we can use to help the children learn about AI. And as you can see in the earlier presentation, why it's it's our duty as teachers to help them learn. This is how we help them learn their ABCs. We help them learn their mathematics. So coding and AI is also going to become something that is that's going to become ingrained into the curriculum as well. All right. So there are many different features that we can use. And what I'll be doing is someone is asking me to share the curriculum and share some steps and the what I'll do is I'll share with the organizers and they will share with you all as well. Okay. So I'll share with Priya ma'am, I'll share with Seema ma'am the link, and they will share with all of you teachers some sample lesson plans that you can all try out at home. Any other questions, fellow teachers?
So only when we explore, we learn more and more.
Yes, true, ma'am. As my mentor used to say, Dr. Ramachandran, he was my dean when I was doing my biotechnology. He always used to say that learning is always, it's a lifelong process. You don't stop. As teachers, it is something that we continue to do right from the time we are students till the time we retire. I don't think there's a retirement for us teachers. We keep on learning. We keep on wanting to improve the lives of our students. I know, and that is something that that really strikes me. How do we make it? How do we make the learning easier for them as well? We don't just vomit it out. How do we make it? How do we have the compassion? How do we have that ability to make it so interesting, make it so innovative, and so compelling for the students to want to learn and to teach others as well?
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
First of all, I need to thank you so much because this is a wonderful session. We are very much get lots of knowledge from this. But the thing is, when we are implementing this in school, because I am really confused as AI is a new session to all computer teachers. When we were learning, by that time, it was just a theory part. I didn't learn the coding part of AI during my college time. It was completely new at that time. So yes, I learned only the theory part. So when we are implementing to the students, it is like, can we start a scratch program from sixth onwards? Kind of guidance can you give us? Because it would be very grateful.
Yes, ma'am. Just give me a second. I'll just share one more thing with you. I think my colleague has shared the website details also in the chat box. But yes, this is our website. So We are teaching, as I mentioned earlier, we've been teaching since last year. We launched AI School of India last year in June 2020. And we've been teaching AI courses to children. So we have for different age groups, we have courses for children from ages 7 to 10, 11 to 13, and 14 to 18 as well. And we also have something called as Indian Mama's Code, which is specially created courses for women who say, for example, they immediately after college, they entered in, they became homemakers, but they still have that interest to learn AI, or they want to teach it to their kids, or we are also providing with a platform where they can become AI educators as well. Okay, we encourage them, we help them, we provide them with guidance, with curriculum and resources, and they become AI teachers in their community as well. So as you can see over here, we have something for different age groups. So not a problem, ma'am. So age 7 itself is say class 2. So a child from class 2 itself is learning AI. you know, with our help. We have specially created courses with the help and guidance of our, you know, international advisory board. So we are following something that has been taught, I mean, that has been followed in the United States, the five big ideas of AI. And we have, what we have done is we've just implemented it for different age groups, helping them learn, you know, based on their different age levels.
Okay.
So you're always free to contact us, ma'am, and we'll help you out. And, you know, we have some, we also have something called as an AI lab for schools, where we have integrated the curriculum with CBSE, ICSE, IGCSE, and we have tailor-made the curriculum according to the school specifications as well.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
I'll just share the, sorry, let me just share the website again in the, you can, please feel free to visit it anytime.
Thank you so much, Borve. My name is Borve, thank you for the interesting session.
You're welcome, ma'am. Thank you for giving me
thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much for that wonderful insight on artificial intelligence. And I request all the participants to make a note of the email ID so that any queries, you can reach out to him and get more information about what you actually are looking for. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, ma'am. Have a lovely session to all the teachers for the rest of the day. And thank you again for this wonderful opportunity to reach out and to help our fellow teachers as well. Okay. Please feel free to reach out to us and to get in touch with us, and we'll help you out in any way that we can.
Thank you once again, sir.
You're welcome, ma'am. Have a lovely day.
Thank you.